Brandon used my strap tonight, so now it's all messed up. It won't work.
And I'm standing on the promises, standing on
the promises of Christ my King.
And I'm standing on the promises, standing on the
promises of God.
I'm standing on the promises of Abraham, my King. Through eternal ages, let His praises ring. Glory in the highest, I will shout and sing.
I'm standing on the promises of God.
And I'm standing on the promises,
standing on
the promises
of Christ my King.
And I'm standing on the
promises,
standing on the promises, the promises of God.
Oh, what can wash away my sin?
Nothing but the blood of Jesus.
And what can make me whole again?
Nothing but the blood of Jesus.
Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fountain.
Nothing but the blood of Jesus.
And I'm standing on the promises, standing on the promises,
the promises of Christ my King.
And I'm standing on the promises, standing on the promises,
the promises of God.
Oh, in the grave He lay, Jesus my Savior, waiting the coming.
From the grave He arose with a mighty triumphal spoke.
He arose a victor of the dark domain,
and He is forever with His saints to reign.
He arose.
He arose.
He arose.
He arose.
Hallelujah. Christ the rose. Standing on the promises, standing on the promises,
the promises of Christ
my King. And I'm standing on the promises, standing on
The promises of God.
And I'm standing on the promises, standing on the promises,
the promises of Christ my King.
And I'm standing on the promises,
I'm standing on the promises,
the promises of God.
Amen, amen. How's everybody this evening?
Blessed.
Amen, amen, yes. We're so glad you're here. You got to know, we have a very light crowd tonight. It's like everybody's with their fathers and their families, and we get it. We definitely get it. But we're here. We're here to worship the Lord tonight,
Amen.
And we're so thankful to do so. So welcome to Platte Community Church for those that are here and those out there that are watching or will be watching later.
Yes.
So we were joking there. If you saw at the beginning, we have many guitars and only a few straps right now. We have to figure out where all our straps are. And Brandon had to use my strap today, and so I had to put it on, and for whatever reason, it wasn't holding on my guitar correctly. So right when we started, my guitar almost fell to the ground. I just caught it, so that's what was going on there. But we are so thankful that you're here. We are so thankful. We're just so thankful to be here. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Our God is so good, and we want to wish all the fathers a happy Father's Day. And because it's Father's Day, we had done something on Mother's Day, yes. And today was the day to bring them back. Does anybody remember what that was? The baby bottles, rubber baby buggy bumpers. Yes, the bottles. So if you forgot, because so many people did, we don't need one. Everybody knows what they are, right? By now you should know what they are. But if you forgot, because so many people had today, we're going to extend it 1 week. So if you get it here between now and next Sunday, and then we will be taking them to Pathways Pregnancy Center. And I know it helps fund that and helps young ladies that are in crisis. Really, you know, they don't know what to do, and many of them want to keep their baby, but they don't know how they're going to do it because of finances or training or supplies. They provide all that, including parenting classes. So it's and plus other things, counseling. It's just a wonderful organization. So the second thing I want to mention is, and we'll talk about yesterday's picnic during praise time. All right. So the second thing I want to mention is the Fall Festival. The Fall Festival is what date?
The Family Fun Fest.
Sorry about that. All right. No wonder people get mixed up on what day things are supposed
to be. Summer.
Family Fun Fest. Family Fun Fest. What date?
It's August 6th.
August the 6th. That is a Saturday. So it means not after church on Sunday. It will be on Saturday, as we have it every year already, from 1 to 6. Just so you know, we have all kinds of things going on, more games. We also found out we're having funnel cakes this year on top of all the other food we're going to be having. And the ponies are not going to be here for 2 hours, though. They're coming for 3 hours. So for the kids that are watching or the parents are watching that have kids, we'll have the ponies here for 3 full hours. That was a big hit last year, and we basically ran out of time. And the bands will be playing anywhere from about 1:15 right to about 5:15. So there'll be music going on the whole time and so much more. So as that gets closer, you'll be hearing more and more about that. We also have been invited to the River of Life Fun Fest, which is on July 16th, correct? And that is also a Saturday from 10 to 4. All right, I'm mentioning that. That's at the old Lake Lehman Middle School right there off around 118. So you want to put that in your calendars because we're going to be going up there. The band's going to be going up and playing, and we can go up and we can enjoy having fun with other fellow Christians. So we're going to start announcing that because that's coming up quick.
Yes.
All right. Did I miss any announcements? Did I do all right?
I think you did well.
Did I do okay? I'm looking to see. I'm going to pull up my cheat sheet here and make sure I didn't miss anything. And I think I did all right. We did good. We had a planning meeting for Fall Festival or for Family Fun Fest on Wednesday, and that went very well. So we got a lot of good things going on. So in saying that, I think we need to do another praise song. Amen?
Yes.
Amen.
How's everybody else feel about that? Amen? Pat says go for it.
So, okay.
Let's go ahead and we'll go to the Lord in prayer, and then I'm kind of rushing through here. We need to pray. We need to go to our Lord in prayer, and then we'll continue on to praise. Father God, God bless you, by the way. God bless you. If you can't get a God bless you at church when you sneeze, something's bad, right?
So.
Heavenly Father, we just thank you. We lift you up. We thank you we can be here as a family, that we can worship you, lift you up, praise you, glorify you. Oh, you're such a great God. And so, Lord, as we just have this time together, we had asked, Lord, that we'd be focused on you and only you. You're such a wonderful Lord. And, Father, we just know we could never even be in your presence without the blood of Jesus. We know it's because of his sacrifice that it's washed and cleansed our sins by faith alone. And we are so thankful. In Christ Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
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 Tonight's message is going to be on our forefathers. And that's not, did you have 1, 2, 3, 4 fathers? It's different, all right? But you know, God had a plan from the beginning.
You're not a God created by human hands. You're not a God dependent anymore to men. You're not a God. Just the way it is.
it's just the way it is. You are God alone, and before time began, you were on your throne. You are God alone, and right now, in the good times and bad, you are on your throne. You are God alone. You're the only God who's present, none can contend. You're the only God who's living, praise will never end.
You're the only God who's worthy
of everything we can give.
You are God,
that's just the way.
Unstoppable, that's what you are. You're unchangeable,
unchangeable,
unshakable,
unshakable,
unstoppable, that's what you are. You are God alone, and before time began,
you were on your throne, and you are God.
Good times and bad,
you are on your throne, you are God alone.
Amen, amen, amen. We're going to take the time, as we do every Sunday, spend time on special prayer requests. I don't think, if you're online, I'm sorry, we have no one online tonight because everybody's with their dads and their fathers, and so we don't have anybody watching online. That doesn't mean you can't send your prayer requests. We will pray for them throughout the week because we won't be able to do them tonight. But we have, before we do that though, and before we do prayer, we want to take the time to praise our Lord. And I want to tell you, yesterday was fantastic. Amen. Yesterday was wonderful. We had such a wonderful picnic. Mm-hmm. And my goodness, how many do we have here? 30-some? Almost 40?
Yeah, probably.
We had 40 chairs, and we used almost every mm-hmm. one of them. And people brought chairs, too, so mm-hmm. that tells you. So it was good. We played croquet. We played volleyball. Was it called beach ball volleyball? So you use a beach ball, so that way it doesn't go too far. It's kind of funny because with the wind yesterday, it hit the ball and it just go forever. Or go like this, one or the other. So, and then we had cornhole.
Yes.
Yeah, I tell you right now, I learned how to score on cornhole. I learned a very valuable lesson. Yes, be very careful playing cornhole with Alicia. I'm telling you right now. She set me up. I already told the morning crew I want to make sure everybody knows that you don't want to play cornhole with Alicia. You want to play with her. She's very good. But you don't want to trust her when it comes to scoring. She told me what I was supposed to do, and as soon as I did that, then I gave Ryan and her the win. So I learned. And just for that, she felt pretty bad. And that's why we have funnel cakes coming for Family Fun Fest. So you made up for it, Alicia. That's good. You made up for it there. So, no, we had so much fun. We really did. Everybody had a great time. Alan came out with his guitar and played some stuff, played some blues, and just had some fun. Everybody just had a great time. So that was a big praise. That was a big praise to watch the family of God just being together and people drive past this place all the time and this building all the time, and they're thinking, what's going on? I actually met three guys that were fishing. They're night fishing for catfish. They said, what is this here now? And I said, a church. He goes, oh, somebody told me it was a church, really? And so I had a chance to share with them and invite them to church. And yeah. We had a lot of visitors today, too, because of the picnic and just everything going on. So God is working in just incredible ways, and so praise Jesus for that. Mm-hmm. Any other praises? No one else has another praise. I'm so thankful that poor Pat could quit sneezing now. I'll tell you. he's allergic to something in here. So. Pat, we're so happy you're here. Poor Pat. You know, Pat was supposed to work, and because of things that happened, he didn't have to. So we get to have him here tonight. So I praise the Lord that you're here with us tonight.
That's
That's yes.
Last week, earlier, Tuesday or whatever, I had a message that I received, I believe, from God. He said to stop being so abrasive toward our United States government and the Democrats and the president, and being so opposed, and start accepting him as your president, and just leave it, God. So I said, okay, so I would watch the news and I hear him say, or the vice president say something. I'm like, how am I supposed to, what I'm hearing? Okay, well, God had to amplify what he meant was, Joe Biden or anybody else isn't God. God is God.
Amen.
And he's in control. He's the one you should bring the matters to. And I says, okay, God, please stop the gun riots. Please bring our fuel prices down. Mm. I tell you what, the next day I started seeing them dropping to $4.92, just see me rooting. I was like, yeah, go God, go God, God power, God power. I was like, wow, God power.
So you know, he needs his car for business. So gas
every fuel station went past, I was blowing a horn and go,
woo. Amen, amen, yeah, yeah, it's just, right.
So the message was, I'm in control. Bring it to me. Don't worry about any of these people.
Surprises God, Pat. None of it surprises God. So that's what I tell people. In fact,
that's what
we get toward the end times, or a lot of these things that we're seeing happen are supposed to happen.
Yeah.
And so,
But remember, God's got us. He's a good choice.
He's
as long as you take his hand.
And if we want our Lord to come back, we have to understand.
But as long as you have his hand and you keep him in your heart, you're fine.
Amen. Yeah. Right. Amen. Amen. Praise God. Thank you.
God.
Yeah. Thank you for sharing. Amen. Okay.
I guess not. I'm happy to see our Linda here because she has not been feeling well. So we're glad that she's here today, too. Mm-hmm. So praise God for that. And we had our Marge here. Mm-hmm. In fact, I think we got to get Marge on the list. We haven't already. Yeah. But she's been struggling with some things.
Yeah.
And so we just need to pray for her. But I was happy to see her here this morning. So today we had, we were talking. We didn't know it. Nobody did a head count. But we do 30 morning bulletins because the kids don't take them. And the tech team doesn't take them but one, and we only have one up here on the stage, so 30 is more than enough. We ran out of bulletins. Mm-hmm. So we have no idea how many people were here, but we know it had to be in the 40s, if not more. So, praise Jesus for that. But are there any prayer requests before that you don't see on the page? We want to put Marge on. We do that? I'm going to have Donna do this because every time I try to do this stuff, I have everything fall on the floor, and she has to pick it up anyway. So. I told him this morning, I said, you think it's tough as a big guy to be able to bend over and pick stuff up? Try it with a guitar around you. That really makes it tough. So.
Will you put your guitar down?
Yeah, I can now. Yeah, I'm learning that. Yeah.
There's something you can drop
get it for me.
Pennies aren't worth picking up anymore.
No. No. Somebody else could get it. If that's
no, it's big bucks that you worry about.
Put sticky in the bottom of my shoes so I can step
on. Oh, you know what I have? I have one of them grabbers.
Oh, and also, we want to pray to fathers that are not here anymore, that when they were here, they were...
With, for their families.
Yeah.
Yeah, for the families, so they don't have their fathers. Yeah, this could be a sad day. Well, then, Wesley looks like one of those Baptist ladies in church. He's fanning himself. He's going, oh, I got the vapors. I got the vapors. What do you, okay, let's get really serious now. Let's go ahead and go to our Lord in prayer then, all right?
I pray for Platt Community Church and its protection and the impact in the community. And Heavenly Father, I pray for Terry Finn, Bill's brother, donor for his kidney. Thank God for that. And Heavenly Father, I pray for Woody's Stan's friend, esophagus and liver cancer. I hope and pray that you're putting your healing touch upon him and making him well again. And Heavenly Father, I pray for Laura's family, the unspoken, whatever that might be. And Heavenly Father, I pray for Sandy's back issues. Hope and pray that you'll put your healing touch on her and just take that pain away. Yes. And Heavenly Father, I pray for Adrian's unspoken, whatever that might be. And Heavenly Father, I pray for David R. in prison, that people would write to him, and he's still with praying and praising the Lord. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen.
Dear Heavenly Father, I pray for Tyson's and Suzanne's dog, whatever that may be. I also pray for April's leg with no feeling in the lower leg. I know you could heal her, Lord. Heal mm-hmm. her.
Yes,
I also pray for Roxanne with the COVID and the unspoken. I pray for Erica's breast cancer. Just put your healing touch on her and take away the cancer.
Yes.
And keep her spirits up mm-hmm. also. I also pray for Nicole's brain cancer. I pray for her, for Jean's husband also. I also pray for Michelle's boss recovering from a car accident. Mm-hmm. You can just heal them, Lord. And in Jesus' name I pray.
You want to pray for Dory White, her heart. If you could heal her, do it now. Yes, I can also.
It would touch her. And for Amanda, Brandon's cousin, who has breast cancer, we ask for a healing touch for her. For Wesley's test, Lord, we ask that you have them come back as a good report. And for Robin, Ryan's aunt needs back surgery. We pray, Lord, that that back surgery goes well and that she recovers fully. Lord, we ask for prayer for Pastor Carlos' mission trip to Africa. We ask for his safety and the more salvations as he's over there.
Yes, Jesus.
Lord, we ask for prayer for John, the loss of his father, Justin's friend. And for Cheryl, stage 4 colon cancer, Lord, we ask for a healing touch for her in Jesus' name.
Yes, Father God. And Lord God, we lift up Melba, and we thank you, Lord. We thank you. The clots in her lungs are now gone, and that she's going through recovery and rehab, and she'll be out and be home on Monday, and we praise you for that. We know, Lord God, her doctor said that he was surprised she didn't die, and to see her recover. What a woman of God. What a woman, Lord, I know that has your heart. She just runs the race with endurance at 80-some years old. She's an amazing woman, and we thank you for her healing. We lift up Suzanne, Michelle's friend, who has to have a double lung She has double lung stage cancer and stage three, Lord God. And we just pray for your healing touch on that. We've watched you heal over and over again, Lord. We have total faith you can do it. And whatever you choose, Lord, whatever is your will be done. We've watched healing after healing after healing in these prayer lists. And we praise you in advance. We lift up Kim, Tammy's co-worker. And we thank you, Lord God, that not only is her COVID gone, but she's back to work right now. And so we praise you for that. We know, Lord God, that that was a touch and go. And again, your healing, you just took care of her, and we praise you. Lord God, we lift up John Golightly. And we ask, Lord, you know, he has that speck of skin cancer on his nose. And Father, it looks very treatable, but that doesn't mean anything when it comes to cancer. And so we had asked that you do two things. You, number one, heal him of that everything would go fine. And number two, that you would take away all this anxiety he has being concerned about it. Not just he, but Tammy and the whole family. Father, we lift up Jim and Jim DuBill and who we call Pastor Jim. And Father God, we just ask that he's okay. We know he took a fall this morning, couldn't even make it to church and hear Suzanne. And we just pray that everything's okay with him, Lord, and you get him back to us quickly. And of course, we lift up our Marge. Lord God, I don't know what's going on, but you know what's going on. I don't know what's causing all the discomfort and the problems she's having, but you know, Lord God. And so as they do the tests and as they look at it, we had asked that it was something minor, that something could be taken care of, that you would heal her in whatever capacity, if that is to use doctors or if that is to just touch your hand on her. But Lord God, we pray that she gets back 100% again. And then we lift up Suzanne. She has an unspoken, and Lord God, you know what that is. And Lord, we just ask that you would be intervening for her on that. All right. And we lift up all those today, Lord God. It's a day to celebrate. I know it was so nice to talk to my dad, who's almost 86, and so many scares of when we wouldn't think we would have him, and back he is again and going strong. But there's so many of those that have lost their fathers. And today is a day, yes, it's a joy of remembrance, but it's also a sadness day because they know that they're no longer with us. We know, Lord God, if they believe in you and if we believe in you, we will see them again in eternity, that we will spend together that time with our family, with our friends, with all those of history who, Lord God, have had their faith in you, Lord Jesus. And so we are so thankful for that. We are thankful for your promise. So we lift all these praises up, we lift all these prayers up, and we lift them up in the name that is above all names, Jesus Christ. It's in your name that we pray. And all God's people said, amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. You know, we have so little here. We have a basket there somewhere, but I was going to say, if you haven't given your offering, you've come prepared, you can just bring it up and put it in the basket. I won't ask anybody to be an usher, because then there would be like two people left. So not quite that bad. We're laughing. That's the way sometimes Sunday evenings go, right, guys? But we have a great time worshiping our Lord, and we are so thankful. You know, I tend to talk to a lot of people, and I counsel a lot of different people. They just call me. And when I say counsel, sometimes it's multiple times. Sometimes it's just a phone call. But the one thing I always tell them, the bit of advice I always give them, is when we get the God thing right, everything falls in place. You know, once we make the Lord of our life, and we practice what he tells us to, everything falls in place. And as we struggle, as we go through the struggles of life and the issues and their stuff, and like we talk about, you know, $5 gas and things not coming in and baby formula not being on the shelves and all the different things. I mean, we get real concerned. We get real worried. But you know what? There is such a peace when we know we are his. There's such a peace that no matter what happens, Paul wrote it best when he said, to live is Christ, to die is gain. that nothing, we don't even have to fear death. And that's because we know who we are in Jesus. So let's go ahead and let's worship before the message tonight with Who Am I?
Lord of all the earth, we can't know my name, we can't feel my hurt.
Who am I that the bright and morning star would choose to light the way for my ever wandering?
Not because of who I am, but because of what you've done. Not because of what I've done, but because of who you are. I am a flower quickly fading, here today and gone tomorrow, a wave tossed in the ocean.
Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for this opportunity that we could be here this evening. We are yours. And I think that's our prayer for everyone, is that they know who you are, Lord. If there's anyone out there watching this, you know, we may be small in number in this building, but there's others that see us outside these walls. Thanks to technology, Lord, you knew that we'd have this. So what we ask today is that whoever hears this, let their ears hear and let their hearts be open to receive the message that Pastor Stan has laid upon his heart today. And we just ask the Holy Spirit that he just intervenes in people's lives and they get to know the Lord. And we ask all this through the precious name of Jesus.
Amen. 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 I need to get a drink here. It's a little warm in here, isn't it? I'm good. Very good. Well, happy Father's Day. We had a great morning service today. Like I said, we had so many people here. And we talked about the role of a father. We talked about role of men, of godly men. Is this question and answer time, Wesley?
In the middle of the message, what are we doing here, Wesley?
I'll let you know that my operation is not until the 15th of July now.
Oh, you moved it.
Put me, not under, but just...
Thank you for telling me after church. I appreciate it.
Okay.
I'm just kidding you. Okay, very good. Very good. All right. Anyways, we had a really nice time. We really had a really nice time this morning. And we talked about the role of a father, the role of a man of God, and not just that, but really the role of a mother and a woman of God. And we discussed it in quite detailed fashion, I guess, and some of the things that God tells us to be. But really what it comes down to is it's our spiritual walk. And so on that same theme, we're going to talk about that father theme a little bit. Tonight's message is our forefathers. And we think of our forefathers, of course, we think of the United States, right? And I appreciate what Pat had to say tonight because, you know, I bleed red, white, and blue. I love America. And there's never been a greater country in history, and it's because of our love for our Lord, and he has blessed it so much. But in saying that, our country is nothing without God. And God had plans. He knew where America was going to be thousands upon thousands upon thousands of years before not only was America, but before he sent Jesus to earth. And when the Bible first was written, back at the first time, in the first book of the Bible, which is what? Way to go, Genesis. Way to go. He's laughing, but he figured it out, right? So, yes. So, way back at the very beginning, in fact, so if you don't know this, the Jews actually believe that the first five books of the Bible were not written by Moses, but by God himself, the hand of God. And so we look at these books of the Bible, and we see, you know, we get into the Old Testament. Let's be honest. When you get into the Old Testament, sometimes your eyes get a little drowsy. And you're just saying, well, we're going to read the Bible throughout the year, and I'll get through this part because we get those begots. When we get into those begots, right? Don't you love those? Yeah, you just skip it. Candace says you just skip over those. Yeah, yeah. But what happens actually when we look in the book of Genesis, we see the first 10 patriarchs of the Bible. And I don't know if you realize this, but every name had a meaning. In fact, every name today has a meaning. I don't know if you know that. Alrighty. And so what we have to do is we have to take and translate it. Now, when we translate it from the Hebrew to the English, sometimes it loses its flavor. And what I mean by that it's not accurate, because it's very accurate, okay? But in saying that, some languages are less complicated than English. And so you don't see words like is, the, and in the Hebrew language, all right? And in fact, you know, I'll give you a good example when you're translating over it. If I were speaking Spanish and I said gracias, the answer back would be what? Does anybody know? You're welcome. They say you're welcome. De nada. Donata. And guess what? And guess what Donata means? No, it means it's nothing. All right. You see. So when we translate now, if you were translating it from Spanish to English, we would say, "You're welcome." All right. So sometimes you have to look and you have to get into it. I'll give you an example in Hebrew, Adama. Adama. Now, of course, that sounds kind of like who? Adam, right? Adam was made by what? I know he was made by God, but what was he made by? What did God use? He used dirt. Adama means dirt or ground. But Adama also could be land, like a land mass. It also can be the whole earth in Hebrew. You see what I'm saying? Are you following me so far? So it's not as a descriptive of a language as what English is. Why is that important? Because what happens when we start really studying our Bibles and we really get into the nitty-gritty of it and we start looking at the prophecies, and all the prophecies have come true, and I think I've shared with you, over 80% of all the prophecies in the Bible have come true. We're down to the last 20%, and those last 20% are the coming of Christ and all the things that will take place in Daniel and in the Ezekiel and in Revelation, all righty? And so we see these prophecies. In fact, in prophecy, you remember the prophecies of Isaiah, almost to the letter, describes who Jesus would be, how he would come up, how he would be crucified, how he would be resurrected from the dead, how his blood, his death would he be bruised for our iniquities, which is our sins, alrighty, and all those things, by his stripes we will be healed. It shows all that, and it was written 700 years before Jesus ever entered earth. Alrighty, so we see these prophecies, we see these things happen. Why do I say that? Because if we go back, if you have your Bibles, Genesis is an easy book to find. Guess which one it is, Wes? The first one, right?
Yeah, the first one.
The first one, there you go, all right? We have a lot of fun. If you're not here on a Sunday night, you're missing out. All right? We have a lot of fun. It's really laid back. So, but if we look at the book of Genesis and we start in chapter 5, we see God really tells us his plan. All righty? We don't realize it because those are those begots that we go past, right? And we don't catch it, and you have to kind of go through it and understand. You know, when you look in every one of these, names mean something. Now, just to give you an idea of what I'm talking about, your name means something too. I mean, you'd have to look up to find out what it is. My name's Stanley. It means king. I am the king of the world. I am the king. All right? All right? So, but you know, we have I actually have two Sammys. I have a Sammy that was naturally born, a Sammy that I adopted. But Samantha means good listener. All right. Jonna, our baby, means beloved of God. Same with John. The man John means the same thing. Donna, guess what Donna's name means? Lady. Alrighty, and so we see those things. All right, Nicholas's name, our son Nicholas, means leader. All right, and so you see these names. Now, I assure you, I didn't say, "Hey, I'm going to pick this name because it means this." No, we just like the name. Turns out, God knew what He was doing. He put it on our hearts, and every one of those characteristics really fall in place. In fact, I don't know if you know, both our Samanthas are either training or want to get trained in school in doing counseling. And it's good listener is their name. Does that surprise you? And our oldest Samantha actually graduates at the end of this year with doing that. So in saying that, now back to us saying, so we're in chapter 5. That gave you plenty of time to open up your Bibles because I know it's hard to find Genesis. So now we're in chapter 5. I've been watching Don Rickles lately, can you tell? All right. So, and what happens is it shows the first 10 patriarchs in the Bible. The first 10 men of the Bible. And every one of their names means something. And God has actually given us a prophecy through their names, and we don't even know it. So we're going to read this, and this is the point we glaze through. And you'll understand, though, when it comes out, why it's so important. All right, so we see this. When God created mankind, he made them in the likeness of God. He created them male and female and blessed them. And he named them mankind when they were created. When Adam had lived 130 years, he had a son in his own likeness, in his own image. And he named him Seth. After Seth was born, Adam lived 800 years and had other sons and daughters. Altogether, Adam lived a total of 930 years, and then he died. When Seth had lived 105 years, he became a father of Enosh. After he became the father of Enosh, Seth lived 807 years and had other sons and daughters altogether. Seth lived a total of 912 years, and then he died. When Enosh had lived 90 years, he became the father of Canaan, or Kenan, you see out there, but it's actually pronounced Canaan. After he became the father of Canaan, Enosh lived 815 years and had other sons and daughters altogether. Enosh lived a total of 905 years, and then he died. When Canaan had lived 70 years, he became the father of Mahalalel, is the way that's pronounced. After he became the father of Mahalalel, Canaan lived 840 years and had other sons and daughters. Altogether, Canaan lived a total of 910 years, and then he died. When Mahalalel had lived 65 years, he became the father of Jared. After he became the father of Jared, Mahalalel lived 830 years and had other sons and daughters. Altogether, Mahalalel lived a total of 895 years, and then he died. When Jared had lived 162 years, he became the father of Enoch. After he became the father of Enoch, Jared lived 800 years and had other sons and daughters altogether. Jared lived a total of 962 years, and then he died. When Enoch had lived 65 years, he became the father of Methuselah. After he became the father of Methuselah, Enoch walked faithfully with God 300 years and had other sons and daughters. Altogether, Enoch lived a total of 365 years. Enoch walked faithfully with God, then he was no more because God took him away. We'll talk about that. When Methuselah had lived 187 years, he became the father of Lamech. After he became the father of Lamech, Methuselah lived 782 years and had other sons and daughters. Altogether, Methuselah lived a total of 969 years, and then he died. When Lamech had lived 182 years, he had a son. He named him Noah and said, "He will comfort us in the labor and painful toil of our hands, because by the ground the Lord has cursed." After Noah was born, Lamech lived 595 years and had other sons and daughters. Altogether, Lamech lived a total of 777 years, and he died. So we see these 10 patriarchs. Now, when you read that, the first thing you look at and go, wow, those people really lived a long time.
Yeah.
All right? And people ask me, did they do time different there? And I think the answer is really, I don't think so. I think what it is, they've come from the Garden of Eden where there was no sin. And they've moved in and have created this sin that really causes this flesh to die. All righty? And but prior to that, man was created to live forever. And so, again, it was God's plan. So when somebody asks me, why did they live that long? The answer is God's plan. All right? But we understand this when we read these things. I think most of us have read this at one time or another. And we just kind of blow right through it. Let's be honest, right? We blow right through it. And, you know, it tells us in 2 Timothy 3:16, right? All scripture is God-breathed and is useful. For what? Teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training in righteousness. So that the servant of God may be thoroughly equipped for every good work. Every time I hear that, I think of the little kids going, teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training. Yeah, in a Christmas thing. So, but anyways, so understanding now as we look at these names, every one of these names has a meaning. Just like I told you the meanings of our family's names. Every one of them has a meaning. Now the first meaning, all right, we see Adam, right? First man, right? Adam, which is actually in Hebrew is Adam, all right? And Adam means, guess what? Man. Adam means man. All right? And we see in 1 Corinthians 15:45, and so it is written that the first man, Adam, became the living being. The last Adam became the life-giving spirit. All right? So they have Adam. Now, Adam and Eve had two sons. They had more than two sons, but they had two sons. Who were the first two sons? Anybody remember? Cain and Abel. Cain killed Abel. All right? Cain was banished. Abel was dead. Do you notice it goes to the third son? Have you noticed this? This is the first trigger when you see that. Why? Because they had the first two, but it talks about him having a son. And his name was Seth. And actually, in Hebrew, Seth is pronounced Shet. All right? And Shet, already, means appointed or granted or placed. And we see when he was born, it says, and Adam knew his wife again, and she bore a son and named him Seth, for God has appointed another seed for me instead of Abel, whom Cain killed. Alrighty. We see that in Scripture. So, instead, that was in Genesis 4:25. All right. And so we see this. And so what's happening is Eve is going like this. Eve is saying, I don't want to do this anymore. You know, I had it pretty good in the Garden of Eden. I had no pain of childbirth. And God promised someday I would appoint somebody that would take away the sins of the world. All righty? So I'm going to go ahead. I'm going to try to twist God's arm and move up the time clock. And here you go. This is him right here, Lord. His name is Seth. It means appointed. You see? And that's what she was trying to do. Alrighty? Now, as we see this, he lived on 807 years. And then the next one, his son, his next one is mentioned, is Enosh. Alright? Enosh. If you know what the Hebrew is, Enosh means this: mortal, or death will come, basically, if you want to break it down in its more rarest form. They were realizing when Enosh was born, hey, guess what? People are dying. Remember when the serpent told Eve, he said, surely you will not die. God said, don't eat from the tree of the fruit of good and the knowledge of good and evil, or you will die. And so old Satan said, oh, surely you won't die. And so when Eve and Adam ate it, all right, they didn't die immediately, but they come to find out, hey, I'm dying. All righty. So Enosh means mortal. All righty. Then we see Canaan. Now, Canaan is the same. It is a different spelling, but it's pronounced the same way as Canaan that we see that was promised to the people of Israel. And Canaan means dwelling place, all right, or habitation. All righty. So where we see in Luke 3:23, it goes backwards through the genealogy of Jesus, and it goes through the whole thing. We're not going to go through all that, all right? But it shows that Yahweh, at that time, God, told them that they possessed the land of Canaan. Canaan would be their dwelling place. It would be the land of milk and honey, all right? And we know that is Israel today, all right? Are we following? You guys following with me? Am I boring you yet? Okay, I hope not, because it's going to come together. All righty. The next name we see is Mahalalel. Now, Mahalalel, that sounds like pretty hard. Mahalalel, right? But what does that kind of sound like? Hawaiian. Well, it does sound Hawaiian, but they didn't have Hawaii at the time of Genesis, but you're right. Mahalalel, what are some other Christian name or Christian words we think of? Mahalalel, hallelujah. Yeah, you see how it comes together? Okay. Which Mahalalel actually means the great God or praise God. All right. Hallelujah or hallelujah, all right, which is just an utterance of hallelujah, is God be praised. That's how close those are together. But Mahalalel means the great God. All righty. And then we see Mahalalel has Jared. Now, he didn't go get a diamond there for his fiance, all right? He went to Jared. No, they didn't go to Jared. All right. And actually, Jared is actually in Hebrew pronounced Yared. All righty. So we see like Jehovah is Jehovah. Alrighty. You have that J sound is actually a Y sound. So, you know, if you're ever looking at Hebrew and say, what does that mean? All right. But anyway, so Yared, all right, means he will descend or he will come down. Alrighty. That's what that name means. All right. Then we see the next one of my favorite characters of all time in the Bible, Enoch. All right, Enoch, E-N-O-C. It sounds like Enosh, but it's a totally different name. All right, and it said that he lived for so many years, and then God, what, just took him. It says that in Genesis. And we see in Hebrews 11:5, all right, it says, by faith, Enoch was taken away so that he did not see death. And was not found because God had taken him. For before he was taken, he had this testimony that he pleased God. That should be our goal. That should be every one of our goals. Like Enoch and like Elijah, that we're walking in such faith that God says, come on, come in now. You're there. Come on, you're there now. All righty? That's only two I know in the Bible that happened to. All righty. And so we see Enoch, but Enoch means teacher or teaching. All righty. Depending on how you use it, but it talks instructing, teaching. That's what that name means. So if you're writing notes, Enoch means teaching or instructing. The next one is Methuselah. I knew who Methuselah was before I was probably old enough to speak. My grandmother on my mother's side used to say, you know Mrs. So-and-so, she's older than Methuselah. And I thought, I don't know who this Methuselah is, but he must be a pretty old guy. Well, as I got older, I found out already. But Methuselah is the oldest person recorded in the Bible as far as their life, okay? And he lived 969 years. Alrighty. Now, Methuselah has some very interesting, it's a very interesting name because it means his death. All right? Basically, when you break it down, it's with his death, it will come. That's Methuselah. With his death, it will come. Alrighty? So it has kind of a double meaning. Because does anybody know who Methuselah's grandfather was? A guy by the name of Noah. Okay, 1 week after Methuselah died, guess what came? The great flood. Yeah. And so with his death, it will come. Okay? Or with his death, basically. All right, is what it comes down to. So we find that and we look and we see that. I always tell everybody how interesting it would have been at that time. You realize you probably would not just know your grandfather and your great-grandfather, but you know your great-great-great-great-great-great-great-great-great-great-great-grandfather. That's what heaven is. That's what heaven is. For those that know Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior, we will be with our great-great-great-great-great-great-great-great-grandfathers and grandmothers. And so we see this. Now, through the genealogy, and I'm not going to take the time, all right, but we see through the genealogy of Mary, Jesus' mother, and of Joseph, we see this genealogy that starts with Adam, all right, and runs the whole way through to our Savior Jesus, all right? And we see in Matthew, actually, and I don't have it, I'm not using it, Ryan, so don't look for it, because we'd be spending all night just reading it all. But we see this genealogy that takes place from the time of Adam to the time of Jesus, in the book of Matthew, we see Jesus' genealogy the whole way through there. Now, 5 years before Methuselah died, his son died first, and his name was Lamech. All right? Lamech is spelled L-A-M-E-C-H. And what it is this. Lamech is the only place we see this in the Bible. We see Melech, which is kind of moving around the letters, and Melech, which sounds about the same, means king. All right? And what you find out is with Lamech or with Melech, it is based on three things in the anatomy. Alrighty. We have Lamech, all right, which is heart, Lev, which is head, and Kilia, which is kidneys, all right, in Hebrew. And so they put it all together and they come up with this name Lamech. Now Melech is the same way, and what we notice is this, is a king has his head ahead of his heart. These were the organs that still holds today. But back at the time that man said these are the most important things on a person's body. Their kidneys, their heart, and their head. And you think about that to this day. You can live without things. You can live without an arm. You can live without a foot. You can live without your teeth. You can live without your eyes. But you can't live without your head. You can't live without your heart. And you can't live without your kidneys. Right? And so they were very serious organs, obviously, as they are today. And so with the king, what it was this, is what came first? Their head, then their heart, then their kidneys. Alrighty. And that meant king. So Melech means head, heart, kidneys. But Lamech, this name we see, the only time we see it, means the opposite. It is heart, head, kidneys. And what does that mean? It would be the opposite of a king. All right? His name would mean the opposite of a king. What would be opposite of a king? And don't think about Europe. Don't think about Lady Di or Princess Di or any of that group. You have to go back into time. What would be the opposite of a king? No. No. That'd be next in line for a king. Right? Opposite of a king. Even worse so. What did kings do at that time? What did they, I want you to think about this as we go through it. You are a king, you take your army in command in, and you go into another country. And you take it over. And they become captives. Or your slaves. Thank you, Alan, or your slaves. Daniel, Babylon overtook Israel, right? Judea? Was it Judea? I can't remember which one it was. Doesn't matter. It's one or the other. But anyway, took it over already. And then Daniel became what? Became a slave. Daniel became a slave. He was in Nebuchadnezzar's house. He and Meshach, Shadrach, and Abednego, they were all part of that already. And so what happens to the opposite of a king would be a captive or a slave. That's correct, Alan. That's right. And so theologists believe that since it's opposite of Melech, Lamech means captive or slave. Anytime we see in Melech, we see in Jeremiah 38, and it's about the king, it says, "Now Ebed-Melech, the Ethiopian, one of the eunuchs who was in the king's house, heard that they had put Jeremiah into a dungeon when the king was sitting at the gate of Benjamin." So we see that. That's the only time we really see that name, Melech, in Scripture, and it's the only time we see Lamech is in this spot here. So theologians believe that means the opposite. Now, we pick up in verse 28 of chapter 5. It says, Lamech lived 182 years and had a son. And he called his name Noah, saying, "This one will comfort us concerning our work and the toil of our hands because of the ground which the Lord has cursed." Okay, so understand Noah. Guess what Noah's name means? Comfort, right? It even tells us. Some of them tell us right along the way. You don't even have to do the research on it. But what has happened? So what we see is this. We see as we go through these things, we see Adam, Shet, Enosh, Canaan, Mahalalel, Yared, Enoch, Methuselah, Lamech, and Noah. Alrighty? And so we see all these things, and we see these words. We see man, appointed, mortal, dwelling place, the great God will come down, his death will send, the captors comfort. And if we break it up, it says this. The man is appointed a mortal dwelling place or a mortal habitation. That's Canaan. And the great God, Mahalalel, will come down, Yared, remember, will come down, all right, teaching Enoch, teaching or instructing, all right, Methuselah, and his death will send, or his death will give, Lamech, the captives, Noah, comfort. So what we see is this, clear back in the creation of time. Now, maybe not the time, but the written word of God time. He had given his word to the Israel people. When we say about, you know, Israel being the chosen people, God's not a respecter of any individual. He loves Americans as much as he loves Israel. But here's the thing. He chose Israel to protect his word. And for the thousands upon thousands upon thousands upon thousands, the 10,000 years. In fact, what year is it in Israel now, written word? About 6,000? Does that sound about right? Right around there? 800 and something? 882? Yeah, so about 6,000 years. He had given this to the Israeli people, to Abraham, all right, to Isaac and to Jacob, who became Israel. And he gave it to them to entrust them that his word would linger on. And it has. Do you realize, there's not a book in the world that's 6,000 years old. And yet this has been tested and proved. They go through it, you know. They said the world was flat, and Isaiah said it was a sphere. Who was right? We can go through the list and list and list of things. They said that Israel was nothing but dry, and the Middle East was nothing but dry and sand, and there was no oil there. But yet it told us that what they use for the ark, pitch and tar. They tar. Where do you get that from? You get that from oil. The word of God has been accurate all the time. And here God has taken and said this, I have a plan. Listen, I know what's going to happen. I know what you're going to do. I know that you're going to mess up. I know that your flesh is going to be in control instead of your love for me. But I'm going to show you in the first 10 patriarchs written in my word what I'm going to do. Even though you're appointed a mortal habitation, even though you're going to be born to die, alrighty, the great God, which is who, will come down. Who would that be? Jesus, right? Teaching. Who else could it be? Teaching. And in his death, and of course resurrection, he will set the captives free. He will give the captives comfort. Amen. And when you look at this, and I hope people are watching online because, I mean, I'm talking to believers. So when we look at this, I hope you're watching this. God made a plan. He's for real. This is all for real. And Jesus is coming back. And it might be tomorrow. I don't know. The rapture could happen any moment. We don't know. But we know this. His word has not returned to his empty in 6,000 years. He's not going to start today. Amen? Amen. 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 Let's go ahead. We'll finish up. Father God, we just thank you so much. You're an amazing God, and I just love it. Every time I get a chance to teach this, Lord God, you thrill me, you excite me, and you get me. You build my faith. I think Jesus, you know, you're really amazing. And I ask, Lord God, that if anybody that's watching this, anybody that's heard this tonight, that not only would it renew their faith, but those that do not know you would find faith. That they'd make a decision for you, Jesus. That they'd make that decision that lasts eternally. We know that your word is true. We know it doesn't return empty. And we are thankful, so very thankful, that we can call you Father, our Heavenly Father. That we can call you in every situation, knowing that your love and your grace is sufficient. We just praise you in Christ Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
I think it's time for some people to stand up and clap. Both of you.
all is dark, you help us see.
Just thank you so much. You tell us, Lord God, that if we believe in our heart and confess with our mouth that Jesus Christ is Lord and God has raised him from the dead, we will be saved. We are so thankful for our salvation. We're so thankful this time together. We're thankful for our fathers, those are with us today and those that are with you. And we just praise you, Lord. We lift you up and we thank you for this time we had together. In Christ Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. God bless you all. We'll see you next week.